Welcome to the Good Karma Sport Fishing Podcast. I'm your host, Captain Ryan Van Fleet. Good morning, guys. Today is Friday, September 25th. I was supposed to fish today, but looking at the weather this morning, it's blowing 20 out of the south. So I was supposed to fish a half day, so we just had to, and it's going to, I'm not sure, it's just a mess out there right now. So we decided not to go today. Like I said, I am like not in the business to force some people to go fishing to make a buck. So I want them to have a good time, and the chances of catching fish when it's really nasty out there or stuff is not good. So anyways, it's more about just catching fish. I want people to enjoy the experience of being out there on the water. So anyway, so we scrapped this morning's trip, and I'm attending a wedding tomorrow. So congratulations to the absolute best mechanic in the Florida Keys, Scott, and he is getting married tomorrow, so we're going to be attending the wedding. So I'm taking the day off to attend a wedding, which is very rare that I would take a Saturday off. So, and then I am back at it again on Sunday, and then I'm supposed to fish. I think I'll probably fish every day this coming week, just depending on what the weather does. So we're getting out of the Atlantic hurricane season, knock on wood. We've got one more month, maybe a month and a half left to go. And it's pretty quiet out there. Just a lot of rain, which is typical for September. I don't usually fish a lot in September. I have a lot of charters on the books, but typically the storms keep people away and they just are watching the Atlantic basin, and then I'll get a lot of cancellations. So that's typically the trend for me. Most fishing guides take the entire month off. And a lot of guys in September, they're deep dropping and they are sword fishing, because September and October and November are really good months for sword fishing down here in the Keys and up through Miami too. I don't know really much about any of that stuff up there and what they do. So we're getting into fall. So when I typically this time of year, so it's going to be kind of a two-fold podcast here as far as tips go. So this weekend prior to the full moon, I start getting rid of all my mono rigs and I switch over to all wire rigs. So because the toothy critters start moving through, and I run wire. I down here, it just seems that especially on moon phases that a lot of fish are very aggressive and they swallow the hooks. So if you're not running wire on full moon phases, then you tend to like lose a lot of fish. And that's what happened to me last year in October. So I ran bait strips with 60 pound and I lost a lot of fish because the fish swallowed the hooks. And it was like a clean cut. I didn't even get to even touch them. I knew they were wahoo because I hooked up doubles and triples. So, but a lot of guys, like they said, up north, and you know, they run, you know, they don't run much wire, but all my rigs get wire. Now, as far as wire goes, I use titanium wire and I use a product from the tackle room called E-Shield Piano Wire, and it is really good stuff. It's relatively new, and what I like about it is that it's domestically made. It's not made in China. So what's happening is a lot of stuff's disappearing off the shelves, and a lot of that stuff is supply chain issues, and there's a lot of people that are laid off right now, and the warehouses are short on people. So it's just a whole crock pot of like crap when it comes to the supply chain right now. So what the tackle room has done with this stuff is, especially with the wire, is they've sourced a domestic manufacturer, and it's awesome. So I talked about piano wire last year a little bit. Now, piano wire is silver, and a lot of guys feel that fish see silver. Well, it's just kind of the opposite. So actually, you see the black wire more than you like black titanium wire a little bit more than you see the silver, because what happens is that black creates a shadow. So when you're fishing with silver piano wire, and you're trolling at like speeds of 10 miles an hour or 9 miles an hour or more, then you have a lot of bubbles in the wash and your sky is white, okay? So when you look up, that stuff's hard to see, and it doesn't reflect and set off a shine. Now, a lot of your pre-rigged ballyhoo, like stuff that comes from bionic baits, that stuff is silver, and that stuff is piano wire. So historically, and you guys know the guys that buy that stuff, they really catch a lot of fish. You catch a lot of fish on pre-rigged ballyhoo. And especially, I used to use a lot of bionic baits and a lot of different baits from other vendors, but the bionic seemed to do really well for me because there was just so many reasons for it, I think. But I really liked that silver wire. And then when I learned more about it, as far as it being piano wire, now the stuff does rust out a little bit, but what's so great about the new stuff from the tackle room, it doesn't rust out. It takes longer. So they really take care of their packaging. This stuff is packed in baby powder or talcum powder. I'm sorry. So it really helps like prevent the moisture, to keep the moisture off of it. And so they really do take really good care of it. And so I use number 9 wire, and I used to use number 7. But what I found was number 7 wire, when you're skipping ballyhoo, that stuff tends to kink and break a little bit more. So especially if your ballyhoo's getting beat up on the surface. So that's part of the reason why I use titanium as well, because the rigs last longer and I can continue to reuse them. Now, as far as my titanium leader goes, I like to use 50 to 75 pounds when it comes to titanium. And all my bait strip rigs are rigged with titanium because I don't want to have to mess with continually having to retie rigs every charter. So and I use bait strips on a consistent basis, a more consistent basis than I do a lot of other products. I actually, in the fall time, I'll use the Halcos, but I really start making the switch over to the bait strips, because last season in the fall, they did extremely well. They got more bites than the Halcos. So now in my new video that I just released for part 3, I go in depth about the Halco lures and the bait strip lures, and I'm not going to share too much with you, but let's just put it like this. There's a lot of really good nuggets in there about lure selection. So I honestly am very excited about using the piano wire this fall, and I caught a lot of nice fish on piano wire last year with rigged ballyhoo. I really did. It was awesome, but I'm more excited about this new E-Shield stuff because it's really nice. I mean, I'm up there, I'm tying rigs this morning, and I'm like, wow, this stuff is awesome stuff. I'm very happy with it. So it's going to catch a lot of fish. And now they're one and done, okay? So I don't reuse these because they tend to, what happens is with piano wire, this stuff tends to rust out. It's just the nature of it. It's just like rigged ballyhoo. It's like a one and done. Don't resave your hooks and don't resave the wire. You know, just toss the stuff. And I'm sorry, guys, but typically like a one and done, like with hooks. All my hooks, except for my bait strip rigs or anything tied with titanium, I retain. But anything that's been through a ballyhoo and run with a ballyhoo, I toss out. So it's just how I roll with it. So it's just that my hooks are one and done. I buy them in bulk. They're relatively cheap. Now, also too, every hook gets sharpened with a file, okay? Wahoo have extremely tough mouths. Now, a lot of you guys are trolling at slower speeds, and just do it like this. It's like the lighter you hammer, like you take a nail and you're not hitting it very hard, then it's harder to like drive the nail into the wood or whatever you're trying to do. So you just have to make sure that your hooks are sharp. And that's one thing too, is that if you're having trouble poking a hook through a bait strip, you better stop and you better sharpen that hook, okay? Because unlike what you read, must-have hooks, every other hook needs to be sharpened, and you need to sharpen them really good and razor sharp. So, and don't worry about breaking off a tip, but if you're worried about all that crap, man, you got issues. So you've been listening to too many people, you've been watching too many shows. You need to have some confidence in your rigs more. So just take the hooks, sharpen the shit out of them, and remember that a wahoo has a very hard mouth, and you have to be able to drive that hook home, okay? So just keep that in mind. Now, I've got my rigging crew that I'm putting together. So I've got 5 more spots to fill, and then I'm cutting the group off because I want the group small. So in the group, I'm going to teach you guys like how to tie certain knots with titanium. I'm going to teach you guys how to rig ballyhoo in that group as well. So it's just not going to be like, you know, and then I'm going to teach you guys how to make lures. So I have one special lure that is kicking ass, especially for a grouper fishing on the planer. It's called the Stimulus Check, and it is badass. And I am not revealing to anyone how I make that. So it's more than just than what it appears to be. So a lot of work went into that lure. So in the group, I'm going to teach the guys how to make the Stimulus Check. So you guys will be that's something that if you really want to learn how some different stuff, then it's a fun thing to do because I'm going to be doing some one-on-one rigging in there. And I want the group small because that way I have time to teach people the tricks that I'm going to show you guys when it comes to the rigs and how to make them. And as far as, you know, how to rig in some ballyhoo in the group, there's just going to be a lot. Certain knots that I do. And there's more to it than just what it is. It's more it's just a lot. So I can't share what else I'm going to do, but I've got some surprises for you guys, and the guys that are going to be involved with it are going to get some good stuff, and it's going to make you lethal. So like I said, I've got 5 more spots. The cost is 50. It's like, I think Melinda's got it for $49.99 a month, and the group will meet once a month, and you have to tell me what time when you email me, what times work best. And then it's going to be a Zoom call. It'll be an hour to 2 hours, who knows how long, however long it takes to answer the questions everybody has. And I have to keep it small because I want to make sure I have time to spend with you guys. So when it comes to rigs. So if you're interested, then you need to email me today at goodkarmaryan@gmail.com to get to reserve a spot. I have 5 more left and then that's it. And then the rigging, then that, I think I'm not sure how long it's going to last. I think, but it's going to be really good, especially for the guys that really want to dial in their wahoo fishing, because that's what we're starting with as far as rigs go. And then we'll go into some tuna stuff, and I'll show you guys how to build some wahoo teasers that I use, and some easy way to run those teasers and all that good stuff. So that's it on that. Like I said, you can email me at goodkarmaryan@gmail.com to reserve your spot. So my next tip today is tuna fishing, okay? There are some large tunas around. So I went down to the dock yesterday, and we have a really big tide, okay? And that's something that you guys will see me talk about here in the future about tides and stuff, but I'm not going to talk about that today. So we have a really large tide right now, and it's not supposed to be, which means that there's probably going to be a really good blackfin tuna bite. Probably more than likely on the humps this coming moon. I want to give you guys a little secret on this next moon. And on this next moon, then you guys need to fish the Islamorada Hump for wahoo, okay? And big tunas, because they're going to be there. And so will the sharks, okay? So the best bet to catch those are in the rips behind the hump. So when the hump flows more to the northeast on the backside where it gets really rough. So that's where those fish are going to be at, and you need to learn how to troll those patterns through there if you want to get them. So the best bet is to fish that hump during the week. If you're trying to do that on a weekend, forget about it, man. I wouldn't even bother. And for you guys going to the humps on the weekend, man, go with caution. It's a nightmare out there. It's a nightmare. And if you're one of those guys that are zigging and zagging trying to troll feathers through the hump on Saturday, good luck. Okay, because there's a lot of small tunas on the top and they're babies. So I'm going to give you guys a little tip, okay? First, you need to get a downrigger, okay? First, then you need to buy the course and then learn how to catch bigger fish on the hump. Not trying to be a dick. I'm just trying to tell you guys, okay? And then you will catch bigger fish and more of them, okay? You need to get one of those, and then I'm not even going to say that because in the last – I'm not even going to tell you. I talked about it in my last podcast about how to catch them on the surface. So go back and listen. If you're into trolling, that's how to do it. But honestly, if you like, once the
groups get there and you get all the charter boats there that are there for their usual this time of year. It's like a routine, man. It's like they go to the hump, they start dumping pilchards out the back of the boat. I call it shark baiting. And they hook a bunch of, you'll hook them and then they get shark this time of year. So your best thing to do is to take some heavy gear there and get a bait down deep and troll and then like really fish those black fins hard and take a couple and get out. Because the dolphin are out there, I reported that last week in my app report that they're in 960 to 1,000 foot. But now, if you're going to the hump and you're insistent on trolling those tunas, then a couple options for you. Like I said, downrigger fishing, learn how to do it. It's only going to help you. And your second one is to learn how to vertical jig. It's not hard. And I talked about that in previous podcasts. And your best jigs are in my, to start with, are in the Good Karma Fishing Tackle.com store. And you can just buy those. You're going to catch plenty of tuna on those. Now, all you need for jigging, it's very simple setup, guys, is a higher speed spinning reel. Now, if you don't want to spend a lot of money on a one that works really well that I haven't talked much about it is the Shimano Bait Runner. Works awesome. The Shimano Bait Runner is an awesome spinning reel for jigging. Awesome reel to start with as far as spinning, as far as a jigging reel goes. It's relatively fast, and the drag is really good on that reel. It's just an awesome reel for the price. When I was vertical jigging hardcore way back when, over 5 years ago, I had a client that always brought that reel, and he always caught some beautiful fish. It's relatively fast. You got to remember that all those Shimano Twin Powers, all that stuff is developed out of the same technology. So that reel is really smooth. I really love it. And it's a great starter reel. So that's something that you need to look at. And you can go to your local Bass Pro shop and see if they have one. Good luck. I was down at Bass Pro the other day. The reel section is gutted. And then you can buy your, then just get a standard jigging. You can, like, you don't need anything fancy, guys. So you can use live bait rods for jigging. I use live bait. I've got combo rods. I use live bait rods for jigging tunas. I like to have that flex. You don't have to get too fancy when it comes to jigging reels, in other words, or jigging rods. Now you can order a really fancy one, or you can just go and get Penn does make a pretty good jigging rod to start with. I forget what the name of it is. They work pretty good. I prefer the short rods. I've got some custom jigging rods that I had built back when I owned Jimmy Jigs, when Melinda and I had Jimmy Jigs. So that's the only reason why I have them, is because that they were built for Jimmy Jigs clients that would come and jig and so forth. So, and one other tip about fishing a hump, before you jump in there, you got to figure out which way the current's moving and which way the boats are moving, okay? Just don't jump in there and start zigging and zagging everywhere or else you're asking for trouble. So, and also too, if you're going there, you need to have a handheld GoPro with you in the event that somebody gets too close or there's an accident, because that's bound to happen there very shortly, because that's how many boats there are fishing with the COVID nightmare that we're having. Believe it or not, you can catch blackfin tunas anywhere in the Florida Keys. So not just at the Islamorada Hump, it's just the easiest place to catch them. But also too, the more boats you put in one area, the more sharky it's going to get. So speaking of sharks, one last topic is that we have a lot of bull sharks in the Keys, guys, and someone was bitten. I think this was just a little while ago. I just read it again in the paper. Now, if that shark really wanted to eat that person, he would have ate him. Okay, so I just want to let you guys know that. So more than likely, when that fish jumped in, it's like anything else. Fish are attracted to splash, and it's a reactionary thing. So when you jump in the water, that shark was probably there, and it was all a reactionary thing, and the bull shark got scared and ran off. So just keep that in mind, is that it was more of a reactionary bite than it was a shark attack, as they're calling it. So, and that happens, okay? It's the ocean. And we're very fortunate that we haven't seen a lot of those in the Keys. So don't be scared, because the percentage is very low. You just have to use a lot of caution, because you have a lot of people that are fishing the reef now, more than I've ever seen, and a lot of people chumming. The bull sharks, when they start their migrations, they're going to be here in larger numbers. So I see people like jumping in the water at the hump, which is the stupidest thing I've ever seen, and jumping in to go swimming at the hump. I mean, use some common sense, okay? So just keep that in mind. If you're going to jump and stop and jump in the water, especially while you've been chumming or on the patch reefs, you got to know that there's sharks there. Now, they may not be eating their bait, but that reaction, all it takes is that reactionary splash, okay, and to trigger something, to trigger a fish. You see that with any type of predator out there, okay? They come to the splash, and that fish didn't know what he was biting. That shark didn't know what he was eating. He just took a slash, and that's it. He took a slash out of the guy's shoulder. The guy's fine. He asked that people quit bothering him. As far as he wants it, that's what he puts. That's how I took it in the article. He's like, he wants his privacy, probably because he's been getting like questioned and questioned and questioned, which can be quite annoying, to be honest with you. So if you're coming down here to go lobster fishing, you're coming down here to go swimming, you still got to remember that it's not a Disney amusement park, especially if you're new to fishing and boating, is that there are fish in the ocean that want to eat you. They were there first, so you have to have some respect. I do not go swimming. I'm like, hey, I haven't been in the water. Only time I go in the water is to fix something, which I'm very, like, try to avoid at all costs. So just keep that in mind. I was, especially with the amount of, if you're diving on Pickles Reef and you have a whole bunch of people yellowtail fishing outside of you, you need to be cautious because the Pickles Reef is loaded with bull sharks right now. And the same goes with the Bibb and the Duane wreck. If you're out there spear diving, you better be using caution because there are a lot of bull sharks there right now. A lot. Guys, that's all I got. I hope you learned something today about the piano wire and a couple short techniques about fishing the hump. Like I said, fishing the hump, where I kind of gave you guys some tips where to fish over this next moon. And there's a good possibility that the wahoo are going to be there on this next moon as they were last moon and the moon before that, along with the big tunas, and then some vertical jigging tips and being respectful about others and using some caution when you're down here going swimming, because we got some weird stuff going on down here with the ocean life right now. So, okay, so that's it. I got to get rolling. So tomorrow, part three of the wahoo downrigger, how I run my downrigger series goes up. That's the final part three. It's really good. You guys are really going to get a lot out of it. And then, oh, I did do an update for the Red Grouper course. I sent everybody that bought the course a sonar image of the actual Red Groupers that we caught. And it'll give you a little bit more insight on what to look for as far as your sonar goes. And I'm going to be doing some more updates with that drift fishing as we go along with that course. And yeah, make sure you follow me on Instagram at goodkarmasportfishing_FL_keys. Check out my tackle store. Again, it's mostly an affiliate stuff for different tackle. And it's a good way for you guys. If you guys have received any sort of tips that have been productive for you guys, I really appreciate that you guys show some support through the podcast by buying some products through the Good Karma Fishing Tackle Store. It's a great way to show some thankfulness for some of the tips that I provided over the course of the past couple of years by supporting the podcast, by buying stuff through the store. I make a little tiny bit of money on that, but not a lot. And Brooke Chris's outdoors video is going to launch here pretty soon. That's going to go live, so keep a lookout for that one. It's a great mutton snapper with some it looks like her hook and cook was with some ocean tally, which looked amazing, and some mutton snapper on a half shell, which is an awesome way to do fish. If you're not already doing it, you need to check that out. And also check out Landshark Outdoors video. Awesome video with one of the best hook and cooks I've seen on YouTube to date with Chef James. And that's it. Oh, my website, goodkarmasportfishing.com. Thanks for tuning in. And remember, anytime you're fishing, it's all good.